So our next speaker is Dr. Savak
Teymoorian. He is a glaucoma and cataract surgeon from Harvard Eye. He's coming right up here. He will be talking about beyond eye drops, exploring glaucoma laser and surgery options. Thank you so much.
My pleasure.
Good morning, everyone. How's everyone doing today? Excited to be here? That's what I want to hear. Dr. Richardson's voice, great voice. I'm going to be the opposite of that. It's okay. Just as Amy, the excellent icon, was talking about earlier, we all have different personalities. We all fit different people. But that's why I love being here. Thank you so much. First, I want to say a special thank you to the Glaucoma Research Foundation, Dr. Bedridge, for having me out here. Thank you so much. But more importantly, I just want to take a moment to thank you guys as our patients. And the reason why I say that here is us as doctors, we do a lot of training. We spend a lot of time doing that. We dedicate our lives, though, to really taking care of you. And what I appreciate the most, especially about glaucoma patients, although it's a chronic disease and we wish we could treat it and just be done with it, it allows us to spend a lot of time with you guys. We actually get to know you as people. You guys probably see your eye doctors a couple of times a year, maybe 2, 3, 4 times a year. I think some people would agree that might be more than some family members you see in a year, right? It's true, for better or for worse. We really do get to know you as human beings, and we really do want to take the opportunity for you to get to know us as well, too. It's a benefit for me to actually spend my life with you guys. So again, thank you guys for spending your glaucoma journey with me. I get to do what I love to do, but it's really important that we get to know you as human beings. Why is that? Because as much as I like to know more about you and what you like to do, I'm trying to help you here in your glaucoma journey. So really what we're trying to do is take you from point A, which is right now, and keep really good functional vision all the way to the end. And I'd love to tell you that your journey in glaucoma is a lot like the weather in Hawaii. It's gonna be all sunshine and rainbows. It's not gonna be sunshine and rainbows, right? We're gonna hit some obstacles along the way. That's an okay thing, because as we hit these obstacles along the way, we're here as your eye care providers to help you pass that, right? Now, if I take all of you guys and we do a survey and I just say a quick game of word association, I'm going to say, how do we treat glaucoma? What's probably the first thing that pops into your mind? Drops, right? Which is great because Dr. Richardson's talk was all about drops, right? Drops are a really, really good option. But are drops a perfect option? Are they the best things that we can do, right? At the end of the day, they're not necessarily. And they remind me of my daughter, Samantha. This is when she was really young. She gave me this sassy look one day. And it made me realize, although we have glaucoma and we have treatments with glaucoma drops, they're not perfect, right? We have a potentially blinding disease and we have treatment options, but why does it not work for everyone? So what are some issues we hit with glaucoma drops? Just show of hands. How many patients have ever had problems with side effects of medicines? Almost everybody. How about remembering your medications, everybody? You know, Dr. Richardson brought up, you know, some of those drops, especially the carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, we'd love to do them 3 times a day, but we only write them as 2 times a day. Do you know why we only write them as 2 times a day? As doctors, we already admit that that middle of the day dosing, no one's gonna get in, right? How about the cost of medication? Who has problems with the cost of medicine? The one thing that really struck to me in that presentation before was there were so many great eye drop options, but how many of them were not covered by insurance, right? And it's almost like teasing in a way, right? You have these big pharmaceutical companies, they spend a lot of money getting a drug finally approved, we get all excited, it's available, but it's not covered. How more and more frustrating is that, right? But again, our job is to guide you in the glaucoma journey. How do we get past that, right? And again, this is where that slide of my daughter comes in. Dad, you're spending all this time, you and your colleagues, dedicating your life on glaucoma. Can we be doing this a better way? So what I want to challenge you is, can we do things besides drops that allow us a better way of managing your glaucoma? All right, so let's talk a little bit about injections of medicine. I know I said injections of medicines, it sounds awful, but bear with me, some good ways of treating glaucoma. So we know some issues with eye drops, right? You got to remember to put them in, you get side effects, there's a cost to them. Can we do it a different way? Well, what if we take a class of medicines, the prostaglandin analogs, the TLTOPs? We take a bottle of that medication, we squeeze it down to about a 1 millimeter pellet of medicine that gets injected into the eye and sits and dissolves over a period of time. How do I describe this to patients? Imagine the inside of your eye like a glass of water. I'm gonna put a little antacid in there. The antacid is going to sit in there and it's going to dissolve over time. It's going to give you medication, whether it's 2 in the morning, 2 o'clock at night. What are the benefits here? Well, it can either minimize or eliminate the drops you're already putting in your eyes. So you don't have to remember to put the medicines in. Great, you can go about living your life instead of having to worry about your phone going off and you have to put eye drops in. And all of the redness and irritation you get from constantly having to apply the drops, well, we're not putting in eye drops anymore. The medicine's already in your eye. And how about all of you patients, how many of you put in a bunch of artificial tears in? Because the glaucoma drops made your eyes dry. Oh, so glaucoma drops are great, but the penalty of putting in your drops is now you're chasing with a bunch of more drops for dryness, right? So you see, here's a different way of actually getting the medication. It's already in your eye. Here's some photographs of it. It's that white little fuzz at the bottom, on the bottom right picture. It just sits in there dissolving over time. FDA has it listed for 15 weeks. Right now, it's a one-time only indication. We're hoping that labeling changes. I will say, just with personal experience, a majority of my patients, they last longer than the 15 weeks, but we're looking for other ways of delivering it. It's decreased side effects. That's right. We'll get to that. Basically, we're going to, I'm already going to take a question here, if that's okay. She was wondering, what are the side effects? Side effects, it is an injection of medication. But I'll tell you, just like when we check your pressure in the office, especially with the blue light, you notice you don't feel it. We use the same numbing drops to give you the medications. Most patients don't notice it. We have a good way of presenting this to the patient. So the patient's actually just talking to me as we give it. Most of the time, you don't notice it. Yeah. Now, besides the injections, is there any other way we can do this? Well, laser option's a good way. And here's another way, or another thought. I say, let's laser your eye. I know that doesn't sound like a great option, but bear with me. It actually is a good option. We're going to talk about laser trabeculoplasty. There's many different iterations to it. I'm going to specifically talk about selective laser trabeculoplasty, and SLT. Well, how does this actually work in your eye? Well, you saw the analogy. We're really just glorified plumbers out there, right? Glaucoma is a plumbing problem. Inside of your eye, the faucet's on. You're creating this fluid. The fluid's important because that's what nourishes the inside of your eye. You need that water, that pressure. But over time, just like the kitchen sink at your house, the longer the faucet's on, at some point, the drain is going to get clogged. Well, what do we all naturally do? If your drain is clogged, how about we unclog it? How about we rejuvenate the natural drainage system of your eye? That's actually what the light therapy here at laser trabeculoplasty does. The way I describe it to my patients is it's like a glorified tan to your eye. Your body absorbs some light energy. As it absorbs that light energy, it creates a little bit of swelling right at the natural drainage system of your eye where the clogging is. Your body senses the swelling. Your body sends these refractive cells to go in there and actually clean the drain for us. So the laser itself is actually the phone call to the plumber. Your body is the plumber itself. It notices there's something there and kind of cleans it up. We don't completely understand how this mechanism works, and you'll notice in glaucoma, even when we're trying to define what glaucoma is, we don't have a great definition. But what it does, it rejuvenates the natural drainage system of your eye. What I like most about this is there have been some recent studies done that compare patients with newly diagnosed glaucoma, and they said, should we start them on drops or should we do a laser instead? This is called the light therapy. It's a big study done in the United Kingdom. The study showed that the arm that was started with the laser therapy first actually did better in the long term. Their pressures were lower, less likely to need surgery, and actually had a better quality of life. And that's the most important thing, better quality of life. So I know it's a little bit daunting when you're first diagnosed with glaucoma. I say, hey, do you want to do some eye drops or do you want to do laser? I know laser doesn't sound like the better of the two options, but it actually, I think it is. Just like Dr. Bedrud noticed, we go to a lot of conferences. I think she would agree with me. We present in front of other ophthalmologists and eye care providers. We present patient cases, much like you guys, newly diagnosed glaucoma. And we say, how would you treat this patient? Eye drops, lasers, surgeries, injections. Majority of them, I would say 80%, would say eye drops. The interesting thing is we say, what if you were the patient? What would you do for yourself? Those numbers typically flip-flop, and we say we would rather do a laser to ourselves. Why is there a big disconnect? I mean, for your patients, you do drops, but for you, you do laser. A lot of it is just perception for the patient. I'd love to tell you we have a lot of time in the office to explain what all of these options are, but usually when we bring up laser options, it sounds too invasive at first. Only if you're in there doing this day-to-day do you realize it might actually be the better of the two options. So something to consider there. There are other laser options available. I'm just going to touch on it. One of them is the micropulse transsclerocytal photocoagulation. Wow, let's talk about a mouthful here. CPC. We love abbreviations. Those are going to be the photos on the left. It actually just has a very soft tip diode there that gives a little bit of heat energy that goes through the white part of the eye, the sclera. Underneath it, if you remember the anatomy where the aqueous or the fluid is made, the ciliary process, it actually causes that area to not create as much fluid. So it's kind of closing the faucet down. Another approach would be the endocyclophotocoagulation, the ECP, which is actually the probe here on the right, where this is actually taken into the eye. You'll notice the picture of where that ciliary body is. That's that bottom right picture. It actually applies heat energy there so it can shut down liquid production as well. So these lasers work on closing the faucet. The prior laser, the SLT, works on the natural drainage system. But we've tried drops, we've tried laser, we've tried injection. Unfortunately for some patients, it continues to get worse. What do we do? So this is what the optic nerve looks like in the back of the eye. I'm a big food person. I love food analogies. It looks like a donut with a donut hole. All right, everybody has a donut hole. The problem with glaucoma is your eye pressure is a little bit higher than what we like. Over time, it's like someone's eating away the donut hole from the inside out. So the little hole gets bigger and bigger. The problem here is we want to maintain a good donut structure. The donut material is where it's at. We want to maintain as much of it as possible because that's what's relaying information from the eye to the brain. But we've tried these other treatment options. They haven't worked. Well, we need to do some surgery. Well, why don't we take advantage of what's naturally occurring in the eye so we can utilize that in our surgical preparation? Well, it just so happens that as we get older, a couple of things naturally happen. I think most of you will be familiar. Once you hit about 40 years or so, do you notice things up close aren't quite as close as you want them to be? You start doing this kind of situation. The natural lens of your eye, much like the lens of your camera, gives your eye strength. But over time, it becomes really stiff and rigid. There's something else that it does. It gets bigger and plumper as you mature. It takes up more space in your eye. Well, you'll notice the natural lens kind of sits in the front part of your eye. As that area, as that lens takes up more space, it does a couple of things. There's only so much room in your eye. So as that lens is getting bigger and bigger, it's moving forward. Well, just in front of it is the natural drainage system of your eye. That same drain that's supposed to take the fluid that you're creating and exiting it out. And remember, we're talking about glaucoma being a plumbing problem, right? Your drain is getting clogged over time. Well, it just so happened, again, we're at your kitchen sink. We open up the cabinet to where your drain is and we look underneath. There's a big lens back there pushing the drain closed. Well, how about we take that big lens out of the way? Is that going to actually help out? Well, that's where cataract surgery comes into place. And at first, when I bring up cataract surgery to my glaucoma patients, they say, wait, I'm confused. I have glaucoma. You're talking about cataracts. What's going on? Yes, they're two separate entities, but one does affect the other. It just so happens for most patients, when you move that big, thick cataract out of the way and you replace it with an intraocular lens, which is a thin wafer of a lens, it opens up the natural drainage system of your eye. That allows your eye pressure to go down. What's interesting to note, about 20 to 25% of patients having cataract surgery, which by the way, we all develop cataracts over time, actually have glaucoma or high eye pressure. It's interesting. We use that as an opportunity to bring your eye pressure down. So really, first line glaucoma surgery is cataract surgery for our glaucoma patients. Go ahead and remove them. But again, we're always working to do things better. If I'm already in the eye doing cataract surgery, can I do something else to help your glaucoma even more? And that's where the evolution of MIGS, or microinvasive glaucoma surgery, came out. Remember back to that photo of my daughter, hey, Dad, can you do this a better way? Well, it just so happens, back in the early 2000s, a couple of doctors, especially one prominent one up in Canada, said, is there any other way we can treat this? I mean, why do we need to do big glaucoma surgery if we just intervene earlier and give something that's more minimally invasive with less risk, quicker recovery, maintaining more of the natural eye tissue? Is that going to give us better results? And that's where MIGS sort of came about. Now, what's MIGS in general? Now, for those of you that like Top Gun, I think about MIGS as the enemy plane. Yes, yeah. Similar to that, but it's actually a category of minimally invasive glaucoma surgeries that we can do. It can get confusing, because there's a lot of new MIGS options out there and there's a lot to pick from. It can be overwhelming. This is where I recommend that you spend time with your eye care provider to truly pick out what's the right thing for you. I briefly want to tell you there's two main categories, those MIGS that we do with cataract surgery and those MIGS that we try to do without cataract surgery. So the ones that we do with cataract surgery, here are the two, probably the most common ones you'll see. Different companies, different products. On the left-hand side will be the iStent or iStent Inject, and on the right will be the Hydrus product. Both of them do the same thing. Remember, it's a plumbing issue. We want to open up the drain and allow more fluid to exit out. But they take two separate approaches. The iStent version of it says smaller is better. The Hydrus says bigger is better. This is where it gets confusing, but again, let your eye care provider help out with that. The iStent Inject has gone through a couple of different iterations. It originally started off with just one little stent, which is about a millimeter in length, that got inserted. Subsequently, newer versions came out. Now it comes preloaded with two, and now there's a version that comes preloaded with three stents you can put in at the same time. The Hydrus is a much longer stent that goes into the eye, goes in there, opens it up, and scaffolds it and puts it out. Now again, different ways of addressing the same issue, let your eye care provider help you out with that. Right now, these are approved for with cataract surgery. And there's an inherent problem here. It's approved with cataract surgery alone. These are great options. A majority of us would say, why don't we do it in our patients that already have had cataract surgery? And here's where the limitations of what we try to do in theory affect practical things. It's available, we can do it, but in the practice setting, it's approved with cataract surgery only. Well, again, what happens to those patients who've already had cataract surgery? It's a frustrating point. Much like all those drops that are available, but most insurance companies don't apply for them. There is a new version, the iStent Infinite, the one that's preloaded with three that has come out for those patients that have already had cataract surgery, but we're working on trying to get, again, insurance coverage to pay for those two. Right? Well, what if you've already had cataract surgery or we don't want to do take your cataract out? There's many different ways of addressing that too. It's called trabeculotomy or goniotomy or viscodilation. There's a lot of wording to this, but I want you to think back to the plumbing. Instead of going in there and sort of opening up the drain of your eye, rejuvenating it, we're going to use tools, whether they're called a hook blade or a streamline or a trabectome. It all opens up the natural drainage system of your eye using a tool to actually open up the drain too. Sometimes we'll squirt a little bit of extra special fluid in there to help open things up, but there's a different way of addressing it. So instead of trying to just simply put a stent in there, all of these products go in there and just literally open the drain up themselves. What I want to take away here is there's a lot of different options that are available for you, and it can be confusing. I always like to give this analogy. Treating glaucoma about two, three decades ago was a lot like being able to order a cheese or pepperoni pizza for your patients. We all love pizza, yes? I love pizza, yes? I'm not the only one. Good, yes. Thank you for the brave ones that put your hands up. It used to be we could only treat it with cheese pizzas or pepperoni pizzas. Patient came in, those are the only options you had in glaucoma. Now with all of these different things that have come out, whether it be eye drops, injections, laser surgery, when the patient comes in, maybe they don't want a pepperoni pizza. They want a combination pizza. Maybe they want a gluten-free version, right? Now we can actually provide it for the patient. We can tailor your glaucoma care to what's important for you. So this gets back to the very, very first slide about the fact that we have this opportunity to really to get to know each other. Please take the time to spend that with us. And look, I'm gonna be honest, I wish there was more time to spend, but there's limitations to what we do. But it's really critical that we get to know why you come in and what's important for you. For instance, why would using a medication that causes metallic taste in your mouth be important to you? It's a critical thing. Please share your time with us. It truly is valuable to us. So no cookie cutter approach to glaucoma. You really want to individualize it for each patient. The good news is we have a lot of options there that we can do. So with that, thank you again for your guys' time. I really do appreciate it. And again, sincerely, thank you again.